we'll discuss about maternal hemorrhage. The uterus, the non-pregnant uterus, the blood flow is only 60 ml per minute, and during pregnancy, this increases to 600 ml per minute, and the cardiac output increases at term to by about 50%. Now, what happens is this compensates for the blood loss, which is expected during delivery, which is around 500 to 1,000 ml. But also what happens is it masks the signs, the clinical signs of shock in a pregnant patient. So the pregnant patient, when they present with shock, it's usually the blood loss is more than 1,500 ml. Maternal hemorrhage, when it is overt, that is when it presents as this, usually we'll cover a few regular causes, routine causes of maternal hemorrhage. When it occurs antepartum, that is before delivery, maybe because of placenta previa, placenta abruption, or uterine rupture. And in the postpartum period, which is the most, the primary postpartum hemorrhage, which occurs within 24 hours of delivery, which is the most common and the leading cause of maternal mortality and morbidity, and secondary, which is 24 hours to 6 weeks after delivery. Placenta previa is usually detected preoperatively. With all the ultrasounds which are done, most of the time you are aware of this, and you can prepare the patient antenatally by giving them enough IV iron so that they are not anemic. And usually anterior or major previa carries very high risk of significant blood loss, and these may present with collapse. Abruption occurs usually in an acute setting. Risk factors include severe preeclampsia with severe symptoms, previous sections, multiple gestation, polyhydramnios, and fetal macrosomia. It can be catastrophic at presentation, causing fetal or maternal and maternal demise. Uterine rupture usually occurs again in an acute setting and can present antenatally or intrapartum. Risk factors are previous scars on the uterus, which may be sections or myomectomies, can be catastrophic for the fetus and the mother. The signs of rupture usually include maternal instability, tachycardia, that's how the mother usually presents with collapse, with pain and or nil PV bleeding, and fetal compromise. Emergency management would require immediately asking for more help and more help. Cannot emphasize that why you will need a lot more help than what you already have. And maternal stabilization with early crystalloids resuscitation does become important. Start two large bore cannulas, collect samples for cross-matching, send for CBC, coag profile, fibrinogen, renal and liver function test, LDH and uric acid if it is abruption. Send for 4 units of cross-match blood. Do inform the blood bank that you may need more blood products like FFP, cryoprecipitates, etc. And have a very low threshold for transfusion if severe hemorrhage, and escalate very quickly to the massive transfusion protocol. We will talk about the massive transfusion protocol soon. Also important that immediately is put in an indwelling catheter, becomes another monitor, gives you another parameter to monitor. Start high flow oxygen, give warm blankets, and do start tranexamic acid 1 gram in 100 ml of saline over 10 minutes. And early transfer to the OT for emergency cesarean section. We will not cover the management during the section because that's going to be as it is for a patient in shock. So the mainstay does remain initial resuscitation, management of hemorrhagic hypovolemic shock, and management of the underlying cause. All this antepartum hemorrhage usually does continue postpartumly and does become a part of postpartum hemorrhage. WHO has recognized that postpartum hemorrhage is the leading cause of maternal mortality, approximately 27% mortality, and very high morbidity. And in the developing nations, it is as much as 60%. 90% of the mortality occurs during the first 4 hours after delivery, so it gives you very little time to treat and manage. And 60% of postpartum hemorrhage could have been prevented. This is where our role comes in. WHO defines blood loss more than equal to 500 within 24 hours of birth, and that is a PPH, and severe PPH when the loss is more than equal to 1,000 ml. Now, there are lots of different societies with different definitions. The ARCOG says it is 500 or more blood loss is 500 to 1,000 is minor, while major is more than 1,000. Moderate is 1,000 to 2,000, while severe is more than 1,000. ACOG says when the cumulative blood loss is more than equal to 1,000. When there are so many definitions, I think that's when there is confusion. So we have to go. So when there is bleeding associated with signs and symptoms of hypovolemia, where the heart rate may be more than 110, BP less than 85-45, saturation less than 95, that is because this will occur in a compromised patient, even with smaller amount of blood loss. Now what happens is during when the baby is delivered and the placenta separates, the physiology says that contraction of the myometrium, which decreases, which contracts the spiral arterioles, and the clot formation at the placental bed where the placenta is separated from, this is what prevents further blood loss. Now, when there is a problem with any of this, or there is a discord, that is whether there is a problem with the tone of the uterus, whether there is trauma of the intact vasculature, whether there is tissue which may be stuck to the uterus preventing it from contraction, or which may be invading inside, or there is thrombin, that is coagulation deficiencies, acquired or congenital, or due to preeclampsia, that's when can result into postpartum hemorrhage. The risk factors are multiple pregnancy, previous history, fetal macrosomia, failure to progress in second stage. So prolonged or rapid labor, both these can. And of course, during general anesthesia, if we are using vapors. Tissue can be retained placental bits of tissue, or it can be placenta accreta spectrum that may be because of scars of the uterus. Trauma can be during vaginal delivery because of the episiotomy and the perineal lacerations, and during sections, that is extension of the uterine vessels. Thrombin can be during preeclampsia and acquired or congenital coagulation deficiencies. Now, postpartum hemorrhage is an opportunistic, so it doesn't look for, it need not be only when there are risk factors. It can happen to anybody, anytime. And there is always, always, always underestimation of blood loss. Blood loss can be as much as 600 to 800 mils per minute, and the patient can lose her entire volume in about 10 minutes and can. And physiology masks the signs of hypovolemic shock. And there is always denial. So these are the causes which can lead to PPH. It's mainly when there is denial, when there is delay in the diagnosis, there is delay in calling for extra help, there is delay in treatment, delay in decision making. As in, there is lack of leadership. So there is delay in upscaling to other stages and to going on to other ways of managing the PPH. Prevention can be by risk stratification. So if you have patients with placenta accreta, precreta, or increta, or previa, you manage them in facilities which have blood bank, or you have them with a facility of where you have interventional radiology. So you have balloon inserted previously. You may build them up nutritionally by giving them IV iron antenatally, so their anemia, iron deficiency anemia is taken care of. And last but not the least, active management of third stage of labor, which requires the giving of a uterotonic at delivery, at the delivery of the anterior shoulders, and timely recognition and early intervention. As I said again, the degree of shock, the compensated shock, the amount of blood loss is usually up to 500 to 1,000 ml. The moment it becomes more than 1,000 ml, that's when the patient starts. That's only starts getting mild tachycardia and there is maybe a small fall in the BP. But when, it's like they're hanging over a cliff. The moment the blood loss is more than 1,500 ml, that's when there is a marked fall in the blood pressure and the patient starts becoming restless and then starts going into decompensated shock, hypovolemic shock. Treatment goals remain, restore, maintain circulatory volume, restore and maintain adequate tissue oxygenation, reverse and prevent the coagulopathy, remove and eliminate the obstetric causes of PBH. So the 3 R's is restore circulatory volume, restore adequate tissue oxygenation, reverse coagulopathy, and remove the obstetric causes of PBH. As first responders, what is important is you immediately call for help, call for more help. Put in 2 large IV cannulas, collect the sample for cross-matching, send for CBC, coag profile, fibrinogen, electrolytes, start fluid resuscitation with warm crystalloids, important to keep them warm, put in an indwelling catheter, massage the fundus, and continue with bimanual massage if required. Check placenta for completeness. This is during a vaginal delivery. Patient has delivered vaginally. Examine the perineum to assess trauma, if any. Start oxygen, high flow oxygen, 10 to 15 liters, and give them warm blankets. Do start tranexamic acid, 1 gram in 100 ml of saline, slowly over 10 minutes, and repeat after 30 minutes of ongoing blood loss. When you start 2 large IV cannulas, good, this is to keep 1 cannula for uterotonics, while the second one you can use for resuscitation fluids. Pharmacological management is going to be escalation of uterotonics. You have already given oxytocin 10 units, IM stat. You may give 5 IU international units, slowly bolus. Do not hesitate to give the second drug. Give ergometrin 200 micrograms IM or can be given slow IV. Oxytocin infusion of 40 units in 1000 ml RL at 250 ml per hour over 4 hours. Can give oral or rectum or misoprostol 400 to 800 microgram. Carboprost may be given 250 micrograms IM if the patient is not an asthmatic. The off-label use is intramyometrial injection, but that's an off-label use, may be given. Surgical management is going to be to take care of, you're going to take care of all the factors. So you're ensuring that the uterine cavity is empty. So ensure it, you may have to do a curettage to empty to confirm that the uterine cavity is empty. There is no tissue or membranes attached. Put in a balloon tamponade. Do the B-Lynch sutures if the patient is at section, which is compression sutures. May have to escalate to internal iliac artery ligation. And if the patient is stable, you may consider moving to an interventional radiology place for embolization. And surely, lastly but surely, do not hesitate to perform hysterectomy as a resuscitative measure. Balloon tamponade is going to prevent, is going to help with the uterine tamponade, is going to seal your 20 centimeter clot area, the area which is bleeding. So that whole wound of 20 centimeters, which is because of the separation of the placenta, the balloon tamponade will help to compress. Various kinds of balloons are available. If you don't have the Bakri balloon, what I did show was the Bakri balloon. If you don't have the Bakri balloon, you can use condom catheters, you can use Foley's catheters, and Foley's catheter, because you have a limitation of the amount of fluid, you may use 2-3 together, and they may be inserted inside. What with all these, you may also need to pack the vagina. But there is this ebb balloon, which comes with a vaginal pack also. The whole idea is to compress the spiral arterioles. And all this, with this, you're going to continue with the bimanual massage and continue with the uterotonics. So we are going to decrease, allow the uterus to contract over this, so the spiral arterial stops supplying, stop bleeding. The brace sutures in the B-lunge does the same. It's like a balloon which is open, and this is going to compress the uterus. There are various other surgical sutures which can be done. This is during during a cesarean section. There are others which may be done when the cesarean section is not done and may have to be done as a surgical intervention if there was no section at vaginal delivery. Once this is done and the patient is still continuing to bleed, you may have to escalate to take care of the vasculature. So trauma, you're going to detailed evaluate for the vaginal cervical uterine trauma, early repair of trauma as indicated, detailed evaluation for placenta and membranes for the completeness so that there is no tissue which is still stuck to the uterine cavity, ensure that the uterine cavity is empty and manage for this. Thrombin, it is important to detect coagulopathy and manage coagulopathy with replacement of blood products. Now, baseline coagulation profile is to be sent at time of cannula insertion. So you can immediately start picking up if there is any coagulation deficiency. And then you can escalate very quickly to massive transfusion protocol. If the requirement of red blood cells, packed cells, has been more than two, it is advised that you escalate to the massive transfusion protocol. And thrombin can be also acquired if you're going to resuscitate only with crystalloids, because then you're going to have dilutional coagulopathy. Now, the blood products should include PRBCs, fresh frozen plasma, cryo, and platelets, according to the pathology findings. We will talk later as to if you do not have any lab findings, what do you do? And do involve all multidisciplinary teams, including the intensivist, hematologist, vascular surgeons, and interventional radiology as required. This is by the FOXI. This shows very nicely that how you should predict, prepare, and handle PPH, the general management, and the stepwise, what you will do for thrombin and what you will do for atony, and the oxytocins required that you can escalate to. This is by FOXI again. This is a PPH management checklist, which is available online, which you can go. And it talks about PPH prevention prophylaxis, where oxytocin is the first line for prophylaxis, which 10 IU can be given IM or 5 IU slow IV push within the first minute after delivery. May add ergometrin methyl, that is methargin 0.2 milligram IM, and may add Mesoprost, if oxytocin is not available or cannot be safely used. For the treatment, you're going to, along with the 10 IU IM which you have given, you're going to continue 20 to 40 IU. So you're going to escalate the use of the uterotonic. And to this, you may add either ergometrin, sintometrin. Sintometrin is not available with us. I don't think it is available. This is a combination of 5 IU of oxytocin and 0.5 milligrams of ergometrin. As well as carbetocin may be given, but it's not available. Carbetocin is a longer acting. Oxytocin is short acting. So that's why you need to continue with an IV which is ongoing so that the uterus remains contracted. Interesting to know that all these drugs, that is oxytocin, ergometrin, and carboprost, we all know the contraindications. Ergometrin you would not use if the patient is hypertensive. Carboprost you will not use if the patient is an asthmatic. And mesoprost can be given rectally, orally, or sublingually, but can cause nausea, vomiting, diarrhea, and pyrexia and shivering. And of course, pranav. Interestingly, these three drugs need to be maintained in the cold chain and need the refrigerator for storage. While mesoprost is the only drug which can be kept outside, so maybe, and which can need not be given parenterally. So if you are in a place of low resource where there is no other access, no parenteral access, you may have to use mesoprost as a first line. Tranexamic acid should be given within the first hour, that is the WHO guidelines now after the woman trial, and should be given can may be repeated after 30 minutes if the blood loss is ongoing. And it should be used within 3 hours of onset of bleeding, because every 15 minutes of delay decreases the utility by 10%. Oxytocin. Also, what is important to know that oxytocin has been declared as a high alert medication. A high alert medication is a heightened risk of causing significant patient harm when they are used in error. So this comes in the list, and it has to be stored at 2 to 8 degrees Celsius to maintain the potency. What happens is most of us, and this is after a lot of papers which have been published, always, always, always underestimate the amount of blood loss. So it is recommended that you should weigh your dry sponges and gauzes so that you can make out how much is the amount of blood loss. So when you weigh swabs, 1 gram is of course 1 ml. And this is the amount of blood loss which occurs on a gross estimation for quick reference. You may put these charts up in the obstetric ward so that it is easy for everybody. So a full sari is usually more than 500 ml. While if there is blood dripping onto the floor, which is definitely more than 1,000 ml. This is also a chart which gives you that how much the amount of soakage of the sponge as well as the gauze piece or the pad which the patients use, that is the amount of blood loss. All these charts do allow us to give us a visual amount of blood loss which may have occurred. Since it is so difficult to estimate how much is the blood loss, they have recommended that we use this V-drape, which is a blood collection drape which is calibrated. However, it's extremely difficult, because not only even if you use it, because along with the blood is also going to come the amniotic fluid. It may be difficult to separate it earlier from the amount of amniotic fluid which may go in, and again lead to a gross underestimation or overestimation of the blood loss. This is the non-pneumatic anti-shock garment, which is available in the rural areas, which can be used to take care of patients in shock till they are being transferred. This decreases the amount of blood loss by about 20 to 30%, and it has a particular wear. It is easy to use, but it definitely needs somebody who knows how to use it. And these are good for as a temporary measure. So when you have to transfer a patient, these are good to be able to use. If you are transferring a patient who is otherwise, you have not been able to get blood or anything, another way that you can do to decrease the amount of blood loss is use aortic compression. So this also contains a wall over here. So that is the last bit. So you start filling in by first putting the first two together. It usually is to be done by a single person. Then two, then three, and then the fourth, and this has a ball which compresses, which is to be put on the navel, so it compresses the aorta. Important is when you have to release this, because when you have to release this, that is when you may cause the patient to go into shock again. Because if you release this without observing the patient, whatever the benefit that you may have got by this garment may be lost. So the releasing requires a sequelae. So first you will release one, wait for some time, see that there is no fall in the BP, there is no rise, and then go on to the second. And in case there is a fall, you will go back and put these on. This is an interesting by the California Maternal Quality Care Collaborative. This is a very interesting definition or this of to calibrate the amount of blood loss, where they say that stage zero is all women in labor or who have recently delivered. That is, stage one is blood loss more than 500 after vaginal and 1,000 after section. Or if the vital sign changes by 15%, so the heart rate is more than 110, blood pressure is less than 85-45, and the saturation is less than 95. We'll come to as to why this is a good classification. And stage 2 is continued bleeding with total blood loss less than 1500. Stage 3 is total blood loss more than 1500 ml. or when more than 2 units of packed cells have been transfused and still unstable vital signs or suspicion of DIC. What they have done along with this is they have given the steps to be done. So the assessment, the procedures, as well as what you will do with the blood bank. So at stage 1 is when you're starting the second IV line. This is when you will send for 2 units of cross-matching if it has already not been done. So this is the action that is to be taken. And then in stage 3 is when you will decide, because where the blood loss is more than 1500 ml and 2 units of packed cells have already been given and the vitals are still unstable and the patient is ongoing blood loss. Now you will move on to the massive, you will move on to the massive transfusion protocol and you will move on to invasive surgical approaches to control the bleeding. And this is the flow chart which tells you that pre-admission and time of admission. For risk patients, what would you do? For non-risk patients, what would you do? High-risk patients, you would already cross-match and keep. Low-risk, you will only draw blood and keep and hold on. And as I said, in stage 0, stage 1, if it is stage 1, more than stage 1, that's when you will just inform everybody. So stage 1 is called the alert line, while stage 2 is the action line. Now, what exactly is the massive transfusion protocol? This is predefined ratio of blood components and it transfuses plasma and platelets empirically. It avoids excessive crystalloid therapy, prevents dilution and coagulopathy. It is known to cause improving the outcomes and decrease mortality. So when we say a massive transfusion protocol, which is set by a unit or a department as to which is going to contain, say, four units of packed cells, 4 units of FFP, and 1 unit of plasma. And various departments have their own. So which we have to decide as to what would be the best for our, in our scenario. And what happens is it eases off when you have to order, when you say that, okay, I have activated the massive transfusion protocol. Now automatically 4 units of packed cells, 4 units of plasma, and 1 unit of apheretic platelets will arise, rather than keep on saying, okay, 4 units of plasma, 4 units of this, which at that time, when there is so much chaos going on in the obstetric ward, this is gives you ease. Fluid replacement is crucial, is the crucial component of PPH, because that is the main, the shock is the hypovolemic shock. And although dilution and coagulopathy may occur with large volumes of crystalloids, colloids or red cells are used with insufficient transfusion of fresh plasma and platelets. So it is important. So that is where the MTP protocol comes in, because only giving red cells and crystalloids, you may push the patient into coagulopathy, into dilutional coagulopathy. Because along with the blood, a whole lot of clotting factors, which have anyway been decreased, are also going to be gone. So resuscitation, these are the ARCOG guidelines, the green top guidelines. So resuscitation by fluids during massive obstetric hemorrhage or PPH. So you may use up to 2 liters of isotonic crystalloids, warm crystalloids, important to keep the patient warm. And if blood hasn't arrived till then, you may use up to 1.5 liters of colloids until the blood arrives. And if immediate transfusion is indicated and you do not have cross-matched or grouped blood, give emergency group O negative, Rh negative blood. I am not sure if we have K negative red cells units available with us. So it says that administration of fresh frozen plasma should be guided by the hemostatic testing, because you have sent all the tests. But so if prothrombin time or APTT is prolonged and hemorrhage is ongoing, administer 12 to 15 ml per kg of FFP. And if hemorrhage still continues after 4 units of packed cells and hemostatic tests are unavailable, administer 4 units of FFP. because you have to replace the coagulation factors which are depleted. Platelet concentrates, administer one pool of platelets, which is usually about 4 units of, this is one epheretic platelet, that's 4 units of pooled platelets, if hemorrhage is ongoing, and see to it that you keep the platelet count more than 50. So if the platelet count is less than 75,000, please do give platelets. Cryoprecipitate, you may administer 2 pools of cryoprecipitate if hemorrhage is ongoing, and fibrinogen, if you've got the fibrinogen concentrate, if you've got the fibrinogen levels, and if they are less than 2 grams per liter, please give cryoprecipitate, because these will be lesser volume. They are actually, though not actually, they are more concentrated with the amount of fibrinogen. We also, you can use fibrinogen concentrate over here if the fibrinogen level is less than 2. However, it's not available. What also may be used in an intraoperative cell salvage device, which is used in cardiothoracic surgery, and it can be considered for emergency used in PPH associated with sections and vaginal delivery. We have tried using it, and somehow though a lot of people say it is easy to use, we found it very cumbersome. A few things to note, if PPH has stopped, so that means if the bleeding has stopped, no FFP is required. If the hemorrhage is ongoing and the last APTT results are available and they are prolonged, that is more than 1.5, then please give 12 to 15 ml per kg of FP and infuse with the aim of maintaining them less than 1.5 times the normal. The aims of transfusion are going to be hemoglobin more than 8 grams, platelet count more than 75,000, prothrombin time of less than 1.5 times normal, control, APTT of less than 1.5 times the control, and fibrinogen more than 1.5 to 2 grams per liter. What is advisable is that every unit which does obstetrics should have a massive transfusion pack in-house, which contains of 4 units of O negative PRBC, 4 units of FFP, and 1 unit of apheresis pack of platelets. And we should look at how we should be able to do this. What is important during all this is to continue communicating with the patient, because it is when the patient's mental status is going down, that is when you start recognizing the signs and symptoms of shock. Because the patient who's otherwise been very happy, she's delivered a baby, will suddenly start telling you that I'm uncomfortable. I'm very thirsty. That's usually the first thing they'll say. I'm very thirsty. Can I have some water? And who will be really restless. Also important is to have good communication within the team. That is the obstetrician, the nursing, the anesthetist, and any other multidisciplinary team that you have got. Your communication has to be closed loop communication, has to include everything that is required. And it should also indicate what is going on. So if you're going to say that it's ongoing PPH, the rest of the team members should understand. Or if it is something like this is controlled PPH, you have to understand that whether you have to be prepared, that are you going to now not activate the massive transfusion protocol. And important to also communicate with the family members, because it's the family members who are otherwise now happy after the baby delivery, everything. And you suddenly come out and tell them that your patient is not, cannot be revived. So you have to delegate a senior member of the team to go and speak to the family, to talk to them and let them know that the patient is bleeding, as well as keep them appraised about what is your next step and what all you're doing. What is important is to have good documentation. So PPH should be notified through a clinical incident. And in your records, all the staff in attendance and the time that they arrived should be written. The sequence of events should be maintained. The administration of all the different pharmacological event agents, the timing sequence, and the escalation of the uterotonics, the time of surgical intervention, wherever relevant, the condition of the mother and the vitals throughout the different steps, as well as the timing and amount of fluid and blood products given. What is important to understand is your outcome is going to depend on the readiness, the recognition, the response, and the record for further management and to learn. Early intervention may prevent shock and is the only thing which may prevent shock and the development of the potentially lethal triad of hypothermia, acidosis, and coagulopathy. That is why it's important to keep the patient warm so that she also doesn't land up with the coagulopathy. The way forward is to have teamwork approach, to have multidisciplinary simulation drills in your hospital, whether you have a simulator or no, even table simulation drills can be done anytime. To have a standard communication so that everybody in the team knows who is talking about. And there is an obstetric hemorrhage kit which is available, ready to use. So you don't have to run, you don't have to find. If you want two large cannulas, you don't have to run to different places to pick them up. You don't have to run to different places to collect your vacutes for blood collection. And to have readily available flowcharts and protocols which are easy to use. Because many a times during this time, is your decision making should be left, you should be able to take care of, so you're taking important decisions. So your protocols will allow you to pick up the algorithms and to continue. Because at this time, not everybody is stressed. The obstetrician, the anesthetist, the nurses, and maybe useful that if you have flowcharts and protocols to continue with the further management so that you can have a good outcome. So I would encourage everybody to input in their obstetric wards all the flowcharts and protocols. Thank you. Thank you.